deception. Secretly, you don't even know what's going on. And I see an attack on our children. What I've noticed over the past couple months is that our children, we've had some murders take place in our community. And that's different for our community. But they haven't directly affected St. Paul, but they've affected families of our children. We have the two men that were killed and burned, and one of our young boys and one of those guys stabbed. And yesterday we know that we had a shooting take place and loss of lives. And that's another dad of one of our children. Children are losing the very people that God placed in this world to give them guidance, direction, and the model of life. So if you lose your model, if you lose the thing that's supposed to provide direction, it has the ability to cripple. But then when the community comes together and refuses to allow the child to be crippled by circumstances, that child is able to go forward. Amen. And so I want to ask that you all stand to your feet. Amen. And as we have soft music begin to play, I want to ask if someone can bring Kimari to me. I want to hold her in my arms out here. Chavez, he's not here. But I also there's a young lady who was literally right there when the shooting took place yesterday. She's ask for prayer, and I want to invite her to come up because it has to be extremely traumatic to see people killed right there in your presence in such a violent way, and to make sure that we protect her future. I want my sister, amen, to come forward so that the ministerial staff can pray for you also, amen. And the saints of God, I need for you all to stand up. Rest on your feet.
Father in this ministry, God. ask you now, would you touch Lamar right now? In the name of Jesus. Lord, we ask you now, God, that you anoint her from her head down to her feet right now. In the name of Jesus. Lord, we don't have any idea of what she's feeling right now, but God, you know right now. Lord, we ask you now, God, that you strengthen her where she's weak, build up where she's torn down right now. In the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we ask you now, God, that you cover her mother right now in Jesus' name. Lord, give her strength right now. God, we ask you now, God, that you strengthen this family, strengthen this men right now, mend the family right now of their broken hearts right now. In the name of Jesus, God, Lord, you have the power, and God, we trust you right now. Lord, we trust you, God, to supply their needs, God, according to the riches and glory. God, we thank you right now. Lord, we thank you, God, for the phenomenal woman that she's going to become right now. In the name of Jesus. God, we cover her in your blood right now. In the name of Jesus. Lord, we can't plead the blood because, God, you already shed your blood right now. And so, God, we ask you now, God, that you cover right now in your blood right now. Satan, you have no power. Satan, you have no authority. We cancel your assignment in Jesus' name. Cancel your assignment, God. Cancel your assignment, Satan, that you have no authority in her life right now, God. We thank you right now, God, that you will shine your grace on her life right now. Shine your mercy on her life right now. In the name of Jesus right now. God, right now, we thank you, God, for punching right now. Lord, we thank you, God, because she recognizes on today that it was your grace, God, that kept her yesterday from the bullets flying, God. You kept her right now. Lord, she came crying to the sanctuary on today. She came running to your house on today, recognizing, God, that it was nobody but your grace and your mercy that kept her on yesterday. And so, God, we say thank you right now. Realizing, God, she could have been dead sleeping in her grave, but God, you kept her, God. You called her, God, and God, we say thank you right now. Father, there are many others, God, that are in this room, God, that could have been in the same position, God. But Lord, you kept us right now. And so, God, we say thank you right now. God, we can't make it without you. Lord, we're crying out to you on today. Lord, you know we need you right now. Lord, we ask you now, God, allow us, give us the strength right now to be able to let your light shine in our community right now. Lord, not just West Augustine, but God, run rampant through Lincolnville right now, throughout the entire community of St. Augustine. Lord, let your blood flow right now. Allow this not to just be an emotional thing, God, but Lord, allow us to see you, God, in this matter. Thank you right now. Lord, strengthen our heart right now. In the name of Jesus. Strengthen our mind. Lord, we know she's seen some things she thought she'd never see, God. But Lord, we ask you now, God, that you erase those things out of her mind. In the name of Jesus. From her head to her feet right now. Lord, what she wants to give up, God, give her the strength to keep moving forward. Lord, we ask you, God, that you wrap your loving arms around Kimara right now. Wrap your loving arms around her mother right now. Around her family right now in Jesus' name. God, we be careful to give your name all the glory and praise. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. thank you for Kimara's future right now. Thank you for her future right now. Lord, her future is full of brightness. Thank you right now. Ah, thank you right now. Thank you for showing us right now, God, her future is bright right now. Lord, you said whatever we loose on earth, God, you will loose in heaven. Lord, whatever we bind on earth, God, you will bind in heaven right now. So God, we loose peace right now. In the name of Jesus, God, we loose love right now. In the name of Jesus, we bind the hand of the enemy and we loose peace right now. We loose joy right now. In the name of Jesus, God, we trust you right now. God, we lift your name right now. Lord, we say thank you right now in advance for what you're about to do in our lives. Lord, you said whether two or three touching God, you will be in the midst right now. And so God, we're touching and agreeing, God, as your children right now. Touching and agreeing, God, that God, you will bring peace in the midst of confusion right now. God, we'll be careful to love you and give your name all glory, honor, and praise. In the name of Jesus. Touch every young person in this room. Touch every young person in our communities right now. In the name of Jesus. We'll be careful to give your name all glory, honor, and praise. Lord, we love you. Lord, we love you. In Jesus' name.
10. Zechariah, the fourth chapter, verses 8 through 10. The book of Zechariah, the fourth chapter, verses 8 through 10. The scripture says, then another message came to me from the Lord. Zerubbabel is the one who laid the foundation of this temple, and he will complete it. Then you will know that the Lord Almighty has sent me. Do not despise these small beginnings, for the Lord rejoices to see the work begin, to see the plumb line in Zerubbabel's hand. For these seven lamps represent the eyes of the Lord that searches all around the world. The title of today's word is, I'm on the way up.
All right. Tell us, sir. Right.
I'm on the way up.
Tell us,
you know, we must not judge people
come on up
based on their struggles.
All right.
Because we are not always aware of their complete story.
Right.
See, you look at a moment in my life, and you judge me based on that moment. But you don't know how many things brought me to that moment.
Yes, sir.
I was reading the online yesterday, and everybody had their opinions on what happened over there on the west side of town. Everybody's doing all these judgments, this and that, and they're researching now. They know everything about everybody's life.
Well.
Be careful judging people based on the struggle that you might have observed. You don't know the whole story.
Amen.
We must also be careful of counting folk out.
Right now.
Because after we've counted the 10 and rang the bell, the one who was down just might not be out.
Amen.
You know, they kind of laughed about it. And after he had been dead for 4 days, we know the story. They counted Jesus out.
Yes, sir.
But I heard a preacher grab his head, rap back his head, but on the third day morning. Verse 8, scripture says, then another message came to me from the Lord.
Yes,
this
sir.
Is Zechariah talking. And,
yes,
and God is still speaking. And as we discussed in Bible study a couple weeks ago, as long as he's still speaking, we still have a chance.
Amen. Yes, sir. Amen.
You're in trouble when he stops speaking.
Right.
You can't hear him no more. He turned you over to a reprobate mind. That's when you're in trouble then. But as long as he's still speaking, as long as he's still tugging away at your conscience, as long as he's still convicting you, still have a chance. God had just spoken to Zechariah in verses 6 through 7.
Yes, sir.
If you look at verses 6 through 7, it says, then he said to me, this is what the Lord says to Zerubbabel. Yes. It is not by force nor by strength,
yes, sir,
but by my spirit, says the Lord God Almighty. Nothing, not even a mighty mountain, will stand in Zerubbabel's way. He's talking to Zechariah about Zerubbabel.
Yes, sir.
He said, nothing, not even a mighty mountain, will stand in Zerubbabel's way.
Yes, sir.
It will be flattened before him. Then Zerubbabel will set the final stone on the temple in place.
Yes, sir.
And the people will shout.
Yeah.
May God bless it. May God bless it.
Uh-huh.
You know, when I look at this, God spoke to the
unmovable in what appeared to be a place of kingdom failure.
Yes, sir.
Sometimes God gives us kingdom work, and then we appear to fail at the work that God has given us. Sometimes God gives us kingdom assignments, and we appear to fail. We look and there's no work going on.
Uh-huh.
And God came and spoke to Zerubbabel in what appeared to be a place of kingdom failure. Zerubbabel had taken on the responsibility of rebuilding the temple in Jerusalem after returning from Babylonian captivity under the heavy hand of King Nebuchadnezzar.
Yes,
I don't know if you all remember the story, but the way it goes is that David had a son, and David's son, you know, David had blood on his hands, so he couldn't build the temple, King David. But his son Solomon, that God blessed him and raised him and allowed him and gave him the resources, the connections, and the ability to build his temple. But the Bible says that after Solomon's death, that the kingdom began to fall apart. It was not the mighty kingdom that had been established under David anymore. But the kingdom began to separate into the northern and the southern kingdoms, and different leadership came into place that was not willing to work together. Mm. They became so weak as a people that they were finally, I'm talking about a folk that were once powerful.
Uh-huh.
They were finally able to be conquered and captured by Babylon and King Nebuchadnezzar.
Yeah.
And after spending years and years and years in captivity, this scripture right here talks about them returning. Here, when I look at this scripture, I see God speaking to Zerubbabel. And it appeared that Zerubbabel, that he was in a place of failure. Zerubbabel had done something that some folk don't do. I look and I see people always have things to say. I had a moment this week.
All right.
I had a moment and God spoke to me and he showed me that everybody that's saying something ain't doing something. There's some people that all they do is just sit and observe.
Come on now.
They observe the people that's doing something. And then they always got an opinion about what the people that are doing something are doing. Ain't doing nothing, but got an opinion on what the doers are doing. They're like somebody that complained about Trump and didn't vote. What sense that is? How you gonna complain and you didn't play a part in the process? They observe, but they don't get engaged. And here we see where Zerubbabel, where he stepped up at the end of captivity, and he agreed to rebuild the temple, because when Nebuchadnezzar came in and they destroyed Jerusalem, they also destroyed the temple. All the things that were in the temple, they came out, they desecrated all the sacred things that were in the temple. They destroyed the people of God, how they related to and associated with God. They destroyed those things to send those people in a place to where they had nothing to be connected to. They had no idea of where they came from. It was an attempt to disconnect them from their God. And their power and their base. And Zerubbabel, when they returned, when King Cyrus of Persia, when they were able to defeat Babylon, and then he allowed the people to come back to Jerusalem. And Zerubbabel was appointed governor of Judea by King Cyrus of Persia. And he agreed to begin the restoration process. My community is destroyed. My community has been brought down to its knees. And it might have been their fault because they walked away from their God. But now they are in a place to where they need leadership to help to restore them to what they used to be, their former glory. And Zerubbabel had agreed, but although he had taken the responsibility of rebuilding the temple in Jerusalem, after returning from Babylonian captivity, for a period of 15 years, in the first couple of years, he laid the foundation. He laid it out. But then, in that second year, work just ceased. And for a period of 15 years, the Samaritans, that, you know, we always hear the story about the good Samaritan, but there's a reason why they use the word good. Because the Samaritans didn't have a track record of doing good things toward the people of God. And so that's why that one right there was picked out. And the Samaritans, they had played a role. They were successful at causing Zerubbabel in his effort to rebuild the temple. They were successful at causing Zerubbabel to put the brakes on the kingdom work. There's always somebody out there trying to slow down kingdom work. When we set our minds on trying to do what God has called us to do and to restore and rebuild, there's always some Samaritans out there that's trying to stop the work. Always talking, but ain't doing nothing. Always got something to say, but nothing to do. And the Samaritans, they were successful. And for 15 years, nothing had been done toward the kingdom work that Zerubbabel had started. Zerubbabel, but many of us know that Zerubbabel, he couldn't blame it all on the Samaritans. You can't just go and blame it on somebody else.
Well,
you're going through, but you can't always, sometimes, every time you go through something, I think we can always go and find the mirror and say, God, what could I have done differently? God, what could I have done better to improve the situation? And Zerubbabel, he could. But many of us know that he couldn't just blame it all on the Samaritans. The Samaritans simply provided some resistance, and Zerubbabel used the resistance as an excuse to put all his energies into building his own legacy.
All right.
Because remember, everything was tore up.
Amen.
When they returned, everything was tore up, but God said, I need my temple restored. Once my temple is restored, then everything else can be restored because there's a solid foundation there. There's a solid base. But in working, the Samaritans distracted his rules and distracted, and he began to look and say, I'm putting all this work into the church, and my own house is tore up.
Uh-huh.
I'm putting all this work into what God wants, and my own life is tore up.
Uh-huh.
And so he has the perfect excuse to stop the kingdom work and focus on his own legacy. It makes sense to a lot of us. It makes a whole lot of sense.
Yes, sir.
He shifted his priorities to rebuilding his own house instead of God's house.
Yes,
God spoke to Zerubbabel after 15 years of spiritual neglect and kingdom work.
Yes, sir.
And said these words, it's not by power, nor by might, but it's by my spirit. The rumor had not done anything toward the kingdom work for 15 years. But God didn't give up on it. God came to him. God kept speaking to him. And God whispered a word in his ear. It's not by power, nor by might, but by my, let me say it this way. You can't truly get you right by your own work ethic and abilities, but obedience to God's instructions. It's all other desires added to your life.
Uh-huh.
Did you get what I said? I might have some abilities. I might have some resources. But I need, folks talk about putting themselves up by their own bootstraps. They just don't realize who has something to do with it. They think that they have something to do with it. Because I was able to meet this person or network here or do this and use these resources. It's me, and they pound themselves on the chest.
Uh-huh.
But let me explain something to the children of God. You can't get you right until you get God right. Because what happens, the Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness, and then all these other things will be added. If I focus on making sure that I'm the man that God has called me to be, if I focus on making sure that I'm the husband that God has called me to be, if I focus on making sure that I'm the dad that God has called me to be, if I focus on making sure that I'm the granddaddy and the pastor that God has called me to be, and then God says, I'm going to honor your obedience. You might sacrifice, but sacrifice don't get you to the top level. But obedience gets you to the top level. And why? Because you honor me, you sow my faith and my righteousness. He said, Ron, I'm going to bless you. And I'm going to bless you real good. Here in the scripture right here, we see what God basically told the ruler of all. It's not by power nor by might, but by my spirit, says the Lord. Somebody say, yeah. Somebody say, was born in Babylon. And in addition to Babylon representing a place of captivity, confusion. And so now this Zerubbabel, he didn't even know Jerusalem. He was not born when they reigned, when they were in authority in Jerusalem. He was born when they were in captivity in Babylon. Captivity was all that he knew. He didn't know a flourishing and thriving community. He did not know people that were kings and queens. All he knew is folk that stood by the river. And they said, and they made fun of him and said, "Sing, how can I sing the sons of Zion in a strange land?" And then the people that hung their hearts and gave up. That's all he knew because he was born in captivity. But I want you to also remember, if you remember the children of God, they said they wanted to build a tower up to the heavens. And then they were doing so. But it was not time for them to reach the heavens. And so the Bible says that God confused their languages. And he named the Tower of Babel. That's where we get the story from, the Tower of Babel. Well, the Babel represents confusion. And not only was this young man born in a place that represents captivity, but he was also born in a place that represents confusion. Now, how in the world can a man that was born in captivity and born in confusion turn around and expect to do a mighty work for God? I need some more working for me. Somebody say yeah. Somebody say yeah. This man, he was born in captivity. This man, he was born in a place of confusion. But I don't know about you, that the ugly truth is that God, he called a man to rebuild the temple that was born in confusion. Did you see what I said? God used a man that was born in confusion. God used a man that was born in captivity, but he still called him, despite his shortcomings, to rebuild the temple that all made some used to be's. Stop right there. Anybody in here used to be a wretch undone? When I thought, can't anybody tell you that God can use a used to be to rebuild the temple? Anybody in here used to be a lion or a whoremonger and a thief? Well, don't get frustrated and give up because God can use a used to be to rebuild the temple. Any used to be's in the house want to take this moment to rally back and say, "Thank you, God.
these small beginnings. You looking at what it look like, and you're frustrated, and you don't believe that I can use us to move aboard. Somebody, you looking at your life right now, and you despise that you're driving a 98, and your neighbor driving a 2018, and it ain't even 2018 yet. Do not despise your small beginnings. You live in a shack, and you living in a gated community, and you just don't feel right, you can't celebrate, and you feel bad about yourself. Do not despise small beginnings. Somebody say yeah. Somebody say yeah. One way, 2 days before payday, you waiting on the shit, and your friend, they still living good. God told me to tell you, do not despise small beginnings, but you got to stay focused on kingdom work. No, it's not by power, nor by might, but it's by the Spirit of God. Do you know the song? It says, Spirit of the living God. Oh, fresh on me. If you fall, I can fly. If you fall, I can fly. Somebody say that. Somebody say that. He said, you know what? He says, don't despise the small beginnings. For the Lord, he rejoices to see the work begin, to see the plumb line in the ruler's hand. Somebody say yes. Somebody say yes. God tells Zechariah to not get frustrated and distracted by small beginnings. He goes further to explain that he has praise also. God says, you know what? I can praise you. I know I asked y'all to give me praise. I know I say that everything that have breath, praise you, Lord. But what y'all forget, only reason that y'all got breath is because I gave y'all my breath. I got breath too. So since I got breath, I like to hear praise too. And the Bible says that God goes into a praise when we begin to work. Somebody say yeah. And he's called me to it. And I put my hands to the plow. God is his shadow. And he knows.